Thank you.
Well, in keeping with the tone of this moment, I'm going to start off with a congratulatory note, because last night I was at Tavern on the Green at the National Board of Review Gala Dinner, where who else should receive the Best Actor Award but Philip Seymour Hoffman for Capote?
Thank you.
Welcome. I'm going to start off with a question or two, obviously, about how this film took shape. You and the director Bennett Miller and the writer Dan Futterman have known each other, I guess, since 1984 when you were at a summer theater program in Saratoga Springs. Now, did this film come about because one of you or two or three of you were drawn to Truman Capote? I mean, how did this all start coming together?
Danny Futterman, he had the idea. He read an article about Capote in Kansas.
Much like Capote read the
article. Yeah, and he had this idea, and he went to his friend Bennett Miller, who he's known since they were 12. They've known each other a long time. And Bennett was like, well, go write it. Because Bennett was kind of like, well, you know, I'll believe it when I see it. You know, he always says it like that. It's very funny. And basically, a couple years later, Danny came back with a screenplay, something like that. And Bennett was wary because they're such good friends, you know, and he didn't know what to expect. And then he read it, and it was exactly what he was looking for. And they sat down to think, you know, well, we should probably figure out who would play Truman. And they thought of me, and they came to my. They sent me the script. I read it. I loved it, and they came to my apartment, and we sat outside in this area, and they said, well, do you want to do it? And I really didn't know if I wanted to do it, because I really didn't know a whole lot about Truman Capote. I knew who Truman was, obviously. I knew the books that he had written and why he was famous for those reasons, and also I just remember being very young and seeing him on talk shows, but I really had this kind of... I remember... when I was thinking about whether to do it or not, that my memory of him was when I was very young and seeing him on talk shows and thinking he was the odd guy who wrote that spooky book. And that was my, like, when I was like seven in my head, I was like, that's the odd guy who wrote a spooky book, you know? And I thought, God, that's not a reason to do the movie. And so I basically started reading the biography and these things, and I just couldn't get out of my head, and I realized that I wanted to do it for personal reasons, and I said yes.
Now, the beginning of the film that we just saw is actually about research. I mean, it's about how Truman and Nellie try to get all the material together. Could you talk a little about your research, both external, in other words, what you were doing to try to get the external manifestations of Capote, but also internal, kind of you and the script, what kind of research that was like?
Well, first off, I had a gut instinct of why I wanted to do it, and that's why I said yes, but I still didn't know what that was. It was just a gut instinct about something that had to not a whole lot to do with the story at that point. It had to do with the fact that he was my age. And that might sound odd, but there was something about being at my age and the things I was thinking about and then reading that screenplay and something about that I related to and something that was happening in that story about the age I was at and where I was at in my life. And I just kind of had this gut feeling that... that at the beginning of the story, he didn't know what to do, that he was at a loss. And I was feeling like that. It was something like that. And the reason why I say that to that answer, that question, is the fact that I got all the audio tapes, I got all the videotapes, and I talked to the people I knew that knew him. I read everything I could read. And I started doing all this work externally. I started doing all the work that I knew I needed to do, because I knew that doing this story, you know, making the story come alive correctly, I was going to have to embody this character in a very specific way, because it was a given to the story. You can't play Truman Capote and not do the things that are Truman Capote. You know, I knew I couldn't call him just be me, just be like, I'm Truman, you know, and be like, I am, believe it or not, you know, and I just knew that would be an awful failure, you know, But the thing, what it was, is just like it was about two or three months of denial. I was in denial. I had forgotten that thing I just told you previous. I'd forgotten the personal. And I was just working out of fear on all this other stuff. And I realized, and I wasn't doing that well at it. I kind of sucked pretty bad, actually. And I would show up to Bennett's house, and we'd rehearse with some other actor friends of mine. And afterwards, we'd walk outside, and Bennett would say, "Don't despair." And I'd be like, "Well, I'm going to, because it's good for me, you know, at this point." So a long answer. It just kind of, I realized that I had to start asking the really important questions, which were, what was it about this story? What was it about this that I needed to look at personally? And when I started to do that work is when all the external work started to come alive. And I still to this day can't really impersonate him in any way, shape, or form with any success if I haven't connected in some very specific way with how I personally attach to that story and that the logic of it and the ambition of it and the love of it and the betrayal of it and everything.
Well, one of the reasons that I find this film so powerful is the layers of the character that you portray. I mean, the hurt child, the celebrity, the self-aware effeminate who will seduce anyone, all kinds of people, to get the information or access for what he needs for his story. And within all of that, it's what you don't say that I found most powerful. In other words, those quiet moments where it's the unsaid rather than the stated that weigh on screen. Could you talk a little about how you got that quiet part, because it's easy maybe to talk about, I listened to Truman's tapes and I tried to get the mannerisms, but the quietness, was that in rehearsals that came about, or was that when you were reading the script?
You're right. And this is something that has to do with Bennett, the director, because this is a highly skilled piece of filmmaking. And I really don't say that about a lot of films I'm in, and not because I don't like them enough, but I've watched this early on and do it just him in the room, and he had talked about what he wanted to do, and he did it. And he wanted to tell a private tragedy of a very public story, very public persona and story, but a private tragedy. And he knew that he was going to have to capture this very public personality, this very public story in a very private, intimate, lonely way. And that was going to be very tricky because of the character you're dealing with, and so it's purposefully done. I wasn't aware of it while it was happening, but I knew that I had to have a certain. I knew that he was going to shoot it in such a way that I was exposed, that there was going to be no way to hide. There was going to be no way to get out of the way of his, probing eye as a director. And so you see all those moments where, where I come. I mean, the one I always remember so specifically is when I come to the door of the Dewey's house the first time. And he actually shoots Truman through the door before it's opened. Mm-hmm. He has those few moments where you just see Truman just sitting there and you just see how he's hungry like no one's ever been hungry, and the moments where he captures Truman listening to Perry in such a way that is, you get to see the wheels turning on how to maneuver and direct this relationship in such a way that he can still get what he wants and still keep him very close and all the complicated things that are happening, but basically so you can unravel this very intimate private tragedy. So that's all. That was all Bennett's idea, and I just had to be as exposed as possible. You have to be as exposed and as vulnerable in front of the camera as possible to get those moments. Hmm. I think.
If you say private tragedy, I mean, traditionally the notion of a tragic hero is that he's supposed to have a flaw, and that's what brings about his downfall. Do you see Truman Capote as perhaps having a tragic flaw of a desperate need for recognition, maybe, as a great artist? Was that perhaps the flaw, or would there be something else?
I had to... No, I mean, it's because it's so, you go to talk about it, you know, and what you're going to say, you're afraid to talk about because you don't want it to come off in some therapeutic way or something that has to do with, you know, my dead pet or something. And, but you know what? A lot of life has to do with the dead pet. And that's just the truth. It's the fucking truth, man. And it has to do with not getting picked for the team. It has to do with your mom not talking to you for 2 weeks when you're 10. And that's the fucking do with that shit. You know what I'm saying? It's like, so like you go to talk about it. You don't want to talk because everyone's like, oh, I don't care. Your life. Is uninteresting to me, you know. It's a craft, you know, that kind of stuff. But the truth is that playing this character, you had to look, I had to think about the story he tells about his mother. And at every, I knew it, as a teenager, it's like, I knew it had everything to do with the kid who was left alone in the hotel room for a good 24 hours and was told, and they were, anyone who heard him was told not to open the door when he was like six. You know, and I think like, and there's like years of this kind of abuse, and not that that ever happened, not like that, but I had to think, well, what does that do to somebody? And I thought, well, it probably, when they eventually get to the point where they have violently pushed whoever did that to them away, you know, like his mother eventually said, all right, you're gonna get the fuck out of the way. And so are you, Dad. And I'm going to walk into the world and make sure no one ever leaves the room again. Ever. And if anyone ever leaves the room again and closes that door, they are dead. And I'm going to make sure they're dead. Hmm. See, do you see what it is? It's almost violent. It's impassioned in such a way that it can't be controlled. And so then you had to ask the next question. It's like, well, then what is that about? It's about love being rejected at some point. There's some kind of love that is being given with such openness and rawness that somebody actually takes it and not only spits on it, but throws it away. So like that's how love has been treated. And so your need for that love is going to be bigger than you're capable of dealing with. There's never going to be enough of it. You're never going to be able to get enough love. There will never be enough love. There will never be the right kind of love. It will never be all-consuming enough. And so all these things I had to start thinking about. But those were really the core issues. And once you started looking at those things, you could start seeing how this story at this point in his life might play out the way it did. Because, oh God, I keep talking.
That's because, what we're here for. It's well, okay.
Because he... Because then you can see how the private tragedy happens, because it can't happen unless love has been expressed. And that's, but I don't, you can see in the film, it's dealt with very subtly, because I was purposefully on all our parts. It's like, you didn't want to see this open expression of love toward this, between the two of them. You wanted to see them both needing something from each other. And out of needing something for each other, they had to create intimacy because they both knew that was the only way to get the things they needed from each other. And there, you're going to fall into the character flaw of that there's never going to be enough love, right? Because then there you open the door, and then his character flaws are going to start flying. Because intimacy will be shared, and once intimacy is shared, there will never be enough intimacy. And there he is in this relationship. And then you have over to the right the other character flaw, which is there'll never be enough love from his fans, from the people, from the culture, from his friends, which is the book, which is him, the writer, which is him, the public persona. And both that flaw is acting in both those arenas, and therefore you see how the tragedy plays out there. He will not win. Both of them will, because of the two of them happening at the same time, there is no winner. There's no win situation. The person he loves, being Perry Smith, has to die in order for him to be accepted in this other. And you see how that is, you know. And those, I feel like, the character flaw, where it comes from and how it was played out.
And actually, the layers of this, I don't know whether you felt one of these three things more, but the relationship of Truman Capote to Perry, on the one hand, it's the parasitic impulse of the writer to the subject, because he uses, you know, anything he can to write. Secondly, yeah, he's got a bit of a crush on him, it would appear. But third, it's the mirror. I mean, there's that wonderful line, you know, where your character says, you know, he walked out the back door, I walked out the front door. That sense that you're looking at a distorted mirror of yourself. I mean, did you use all three of those thematic or emotional things the same, or was one dominant of those three?
Well, why he connected to him is why he connected to him, why there was some kind of affection or intimacy shared, had to do something with probably a common ground, which I think is that they're both orphaned, basically. And he's an artist, Perry, ultimately, and not a very bad one, actually. And he's actually somewhat good. Like, you could see there was promise there in something that might have been but damaged. And there's the intimacy. But I have to say, is more than a crush. You know, Truman was, I mean, you know, in researching it after the fact, he never got as close to anybody as Perry. He'd say things like this, and I think you see that in that final scene. I mean, that was hopefully what would happen, isn't it, that you would see somebody heartbroken beyond belief and grief-stricken to the point of where it was going to change his life, you know. And I don't think it was just because he had betrayed him. Yeah. You know what I mean? I think it was literally because he had not only betrayed him and done all those things, but just what he felt about him was going to be expressed very strongly in that moment. But yeah, it was. I think it was more than that. Yeah.
Okay. Now, I know that you improvised at least one of the scenes in the film right after the reading. And in fact, I hope you are all aware that the reading that we see in the film of Truman Capote reading from In Cold Blood
happened here,
on this stage. This stage, I mean, in the early 60s. I mean, what a thrill it is for me to be sitting here
actually,
with you on
it
this
is, stage. It is actually kind of similar to the one we shot in. It's pretty wild that I'm
Which
out here now.
Which was not in even New York, I guess?
It was in Winnipeg, yeah. It was in Canada.
Well, they can never get this particular auditorium to shoot in because it's in use every single night with so many great cultural events.
Yeah.
But yeah, this was the place, and the scene right after, you talk about suddenly you realize that your pants had been ripped and all you felt was the draft. I know that that was improvised from something that you had said about a theater experience of yours.
Yeah.
It just leads me to ask about how much improvisation there was, because it seemed like a very tightly scripted film, but I'm guessing that maybe during rehearsal or afterwards, there was some degree where you brought in, you know, things that changed it.
Yeah, it was... It's a sparse script. It was sparse on purpose. Again, going back to the whole private tragedy thing, you know, you wanted to see things more than hear them. And but there were moments that you had to capture the public persona in order to make that theory work in the film. You had to see this private thing happening, juxtaposed or butted up right up against this very public figure, one of the best self-promoters I think this country's ever, you know, produced. And so in those scenes, we had to create an environment when you're dealing with a lot of extras, when you're in front of a lot of people who don't know you and they're there and there they are and they're going to be there listening to it, you know, for a few hours, take after take and that kind of thing. And you have to create an environment where everyone's going to act honestly. And also with the little dialogue that we had there, we knew that we needed more. He needed to take the room. He needed to run the show. And so I improvised the majority of the three party scenes, the opening scene, the scene at his house, and then the scene backstage at the Y. Are pretty much improvised. There might be a line or two that was written, but the improvisation worked around that line, like the Jimmy Baldwin story was written, but I improvised before it and after it, and in the other scenes also, yeah.
Okay.
And then there were little moments throughout the film, but those were primarily the moments.
Actually, even visually, I mean, I'm remembering the party scene, certainly the first one, as visually, you know, handheld camera, there's a kind of jittery feeling, whereas so much of the rest of the film has an almost stately, spare quality.
Yes.
So it's interesting that you actually said something in Telluride on the panel, I'm just remembering, break the rhythm. I think that was you who talked about when something isn't working or whatever, break the rhythm.
Yeah.
The film sometimes breaks a rhythm, moves into almost musically something else, and then comes back again.
Well, I think the party scenes are shot in a way, Ben would probably say this better than me, where you should feel like you're in the room.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so you can actually objectively watch him and judge him and criticize him. You know, it's so that he's shown in almost the most critical light possible, as if you were somebody in the back of the crowd looking through and like watching this guy and really watching him and really seeing what he's saying, hearing what he's saying and all that. I think that was done on purpose. Whereas opposed to the other stuff is him being very exposed, very up close. And
yeah, this is a film that I think has more close-ups than most of the films I've seen this year.
It's well, you mean a lot, you know, 30% of the film takes place in a very small place, you know, that cell. I mean, really, that would really barely fit. It was like, boom, right there.
Yeah, and I'm even remembering that the one time I can't see your face, it's very important. Later in the film, you're behind a door that's essentially a cage. I mean, you basically see the bars. Mm-hmm. And we can't quite see your face, and you seem to be as imprisoned at that moment as Perry is physically. Mm. And it's a very effective way, I think, to, again, be telling the story visually rather than merely through the dialogue.
Right, right.
One more question that is perhaps more technique-oriented, because I think many of us do want to know a little about it. Among the greatest challenges for you in playing this character, was it the physical, for example, losing 40 pounds? You know, was that something that was
I've gained it back, by the way.
Was it vocal?
It's so fucked up. Isn't it? It's like I shot this movie a year ago, and I'm already like, fucking fat. You're gonna... Good old American, you know what I mean?
You could only be Truman for so long.
Like, yeah, yeah, God. it's so funny. It's not really that funny, actually. It's kind of sad. I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. It's nice to see the range of voices and attitudes in you. but vocally, too, I mean, once you had obviously really gotten that voice, did you, for example, keep using it even when you weren't shooting, like, you know, off the set? Or, you know, I mean, was it something that was really a part of you at that point, or were you in and out of it?
Those are good questions, because I think there's a kind of mythology around that because of Brando or Daniel Day-Lewis or these people, you know, De Niro or whatever, that they lost the weight and they became the person and they had to go into therapy afterwards or something to get you find themselves again. And that's not really the case. What it is is that some actors, I think, and I'm that actor sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes I'm going to play a role that where not only logically and thought-wise is a character different than I am, ultimately, but the way they behave and talk. And sometimes it's not even a real person. Sometimes I just realize there are choices that need to be made that will make it more interesting. And that means you basically have to rewire yourself in a way. You have to train yourself as like an athlete trains themselves. And I've actually talked to athletes about this, you know, and it's very similar. You're training for an event that's going to come up, and you want your body to behave appropriately, you know, and it takes a certain amount of focus and concentration. You're also training for that. And that's really what it is. And so then when you get to the race, you can't stop the race. If you stop the race, everyone knows this. It's like when you go running, you know, and if I'm going to run 4 miles, you know, and you're like, I'm going to run, you know, and you start running, you know, and then like 2 miles into it, you're like, I'm going to take a break. And if you stop, you don't run the next 2 miles. You know what I mean? I mean, some of you might, but I don't, you know, you basically stop and you're like, you know, there's my cigarettes, you know, and it's the same thing for this. You're going through the day, shooting through the day, and the voice and the physicality is something that's so different from you that if you let it down, it's so hard to pick back up again. The will to pick it back up again is difficult. So you basically want to keep a certain sense of rhythm and vocal range and physicality through the day that's similar to this character that's very different from you. So you're always, it's right there at your fingertips. And then at the end of the day, you drop it and you go take a rest, you know. But it's not so much the psychological thing, it's more the technical, athletic kind of that you've trained, and here you are, and you need to stay there.
Sure. And if I may ask, how long did you train? In other words, how long was this process of preparing for the part?
It was about 6 weeks, 6 weeks, 6 months.
I was going to say, yeah.
Whipped it in a weekend, I just put it together. No, but it was about 6 months. Seriously, it was about 6 months to lose the weight, to learn everything, to get into all the personal work, everything. And then even when we were shooting it, I don't think I was fumbling and stumbling for a good 3 weeks. Mm. And that's the truth. It was really, really a long, most the longest time.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, I saw on this show that I actually watch every Sunday morning, Shootout with the two Peters, two casting directors a couple of months ago, this was back in September, mentioned you as having turned down three big studio films.
They did?
They did. This was Janet Hershenson, and I forgot the other woman's name. And it just led me to a curiosity about your criteria for choosing roles, because as we saw from the clips, I mean, you've chosen to work in some wonderful, quirky films in relatively small parts. You take Capote, but I gather you turn down a lot of bigger films. Mm. Is it primarily the script? Is it the director that you're going to work with? Are there other rationale?
There's a lot of reasons. I mean, I could have turned down those three films because I was already working on something. Could have been as simple as that. Or I could have just come off something. That's a lot of the reasons sometimes. Like right now, going through this this stuff, the award stuff and those kinds of things, I don't know if it's you're very busy. You're going to, like every night there's something to do, you know. And I was actually just on the phone today with my agent, and I was just trying to tell him, like, I can't make a decision right now. It's a bad time to make a decision, you know. You realize it's not the time to make a decision. It's going to be skewed. It's going to be colored by something that's, you know, not the reason why you should be making the decision. So it could be that reason. But when it gets down to just actually when you're free and you're there and you want to work and you're looking for a job, it's hard to say. It's what's supposed to be next, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. You want to try to control your life. I think everybody does. You want to try to have some control over your future or make plans. And we all kind of know that that kind of works 30% of the time. That plans and your control really are a bunch of nonsense up to a point, except for like getting up and going to bed and eating and stuff and showing up at things. But basically what happens inside all of that is really, you know, you do your best. And it's the same, you know, with this. It's not, you know, you all understand what I'm saying. It's just, you can't force it. You can't put a square into a round hole. You can't anything. So sometimes you'll read something, you like it very much, but you just know it's not right. And then sometimes you debate about something for a long, like Long Day's Journey Tonight. I was like 2 years I've been offered that part. And I was like, no, yes, no, yeah, I don't know. And then one time I was like, yeah. And I just knew it was like the day came and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do that play now. And so it's not a better answer, but that's really about.
And I guess you don't have an aversion to big studio films. You went, I gather, straight from Capote into Mission Impossible 3.
Yeah, I did that. I started Mission Impossible 3 at in June. We ended in December. Crazy. That's a great read. They had offered me a part in Mission Impossible 3 about, if this is interesting to you guys, like a year and a half before that. And something happened and it fell apart. The director left and something like that, and I was like, all right. And it was very confusing, really weird. And I thought, well, I'll never do that again. I won't be doing that movie. And then a year later, my friend J.J. Abrams calls, who directed Mission Impossible 3, who created Lost and all those shows. And I've known him since my early 20s. And he calls me on the phone and he's very smart, very funny, and great guy. And he's like, I want you to do this. I'm like, really? I mean, are you going to be director? Are you going to quit too? You know, and anyway, he sent me the script. He had rewritten it. I read it. It was funny and smart, just like JJ is. And I called him up. I said, yeah, let's do it. And it just all kind of fell into place. You know, you realize it's like, okay, this is the time to play the villain in this movie, you know, to do that thing that you've never done. If you're going to do it with JJ. And then, you know, you do it.
I kind of like the idea that it's right after playing Truman Capote that you find the villainous part that you can...
Yeah, it was, yeah. Yeah, he's really bad.
And you mentioned Long Day's Journey, so I just want to acknowledge, first of all, because most of this audience, I think, is familiar much more with your film work than your stage work, but boy, do I remember you in The Seagull, which a couple of summers ago was done in Central Park, directed by Mike Nichols, and you played Kolya, the unloved son of Meryl Streep's Irina, and your co-artistic director of the Labyrinth Theatre Company here. In terms of this notion of the time is right for this or that, do you consciously make time to do stage work in between the films? Do you have to really budget that properly? I mean, what role does the stage play for you these days?
It's a huge part. It's a bigger part of my life than film, actually, because of the theater company and running it in some way. I just came from the board meeting for the theater company. I direct with them, but it's the same thing. Something will come around, something will come up, and I'll be like, I want to do that. I want to act in that play. But I try not to force it. I try not to say, okay, I'm going to act in, I don't know what play, but come March, I'll be in a play. I'm not going to do that. But I'm going to probably act in a play next season, this play that I did a reading of with John Ortiz and my company of this new play, and I'm going to do it. You know, and that's really what happens. It's very similar criteria. The only thing I would say is that I have purposely put both of them in my life in a major way because I know that acting on the stage and acting in front of a camera, that if you only do one, A, you get burnt out. You really get burnt out. And muscles atrophy because you use different ones in both mediums. You use similar ones, but there's some that are different. And if you stay in one too long, the other one will atrophy in a certain way. And I learned that when I was younger, and I always remembered it. So I always stay around both places because I know it's good for me.
That's good. And also, I should mention that Columbia University has benefited from you, too, because even though we never saw each other at Columbia last year, you taught the Directing the Actor workshop in the Graduate Film Division at Columbia. So I'm so proud that you've been on our faculty and are my colleague, even though we didn't meet. Yeah. In a moment, we're going to take questions from the audience, if we could raise the lights a little. But I did want to raise one, because I was curious about this. There is a rival Capote project that's going to be released this year. Uh-huh. It has different titles. Have You Heard is one of them. Infamous is the other. This is a film based on George Plimpton's book, directed by Doug McGrath, that basically, I gather, follows Truman Capote at the same time when he was writing In Cold Blood.
Yes.
Have you seen the film yet? At what point are you going to see the film? Do you have any feelings about this?
Both films were trying to get made at the same time. And when we were trying to get our film made, they already were with the studio. They had money, you know, and we really felt like we'd never get our film made. It was a tricky time. But we just moved ahead, and we both pretty much made our films kind of at the same time. I've never read the script. I've never seen the film. I know some of the people in it. But once we got deep enough into making this film, I had no space in my head to think about it.
Sure.
It was really a done deal, and that was kind of like c'est la vie, and good luck to you kind of thing, and now I think they're going to come out release next fall or something like that. But they can't be the same. You know what I mean? After a while I realized it's like they're just going to be so different, it's going to be crazy. I just know it, you know what I mean? So they're both going to be worthy of themselves.
I mean, I can picture the day, maybe 20 years from now, when dissertations will be written comparing the two Capote films that came out around the same time.
Frankly, I won't be there.
I mean, some of my students these days do very good extended analyses of Dangerous Liaisons and Valmont, which came out within 1 year of each other, completely overlapping because they were adapted from the same basic source text, but ultimately extremely different in their treatment, and both, I think, very worthy. I know that there are people here with questions, so if we can raise the lights, there's a woman back there and someone right down here, and then and make sure that if you're in the balcony, you yell so that I can definitely call on you. Yes.
Thank you.
I'll repeat the question. We thought the film was marvelous, but felt we have to raise the question that in the film, your character is clearly meticulous in every way, except in the close-ups of the hands, you see that the fingernails are a bit dirty. Was that intentional, or was that an oversight in the film?
Yes, I had a fingernail dirty, get dirty person on the film who actually came up before each shot and made sure I had a sufficient amount of dirt under it. No, he's an alcoholic, people. He's an alcoholic. He knows how to dress. You know, it's like, and all the times watching him, I never got the feeling that his hands weren't, you know, manicured. You know, I never had that feeling. And I always had a feeling that it was like something to leave alone. And I remember even halfway through thinking like, oh God, your nails are dirty. It's like, ah, fuck it. You know, and you're like the third or fourth person actually who's asked that, and to me it made absolute sense that a man like that would be that well dressed and have dirty fingernails. It just did.
Actually, I even had another theory when I was watching it for the second time. This is way before people had computers, and we see that even before you go to a typewriter, you're writing. And I assume that maybe it's the writer in you who's got the pencils and whatever, that the nails would be related to the actual pencil or ink.
I just didn't wash his hands.
Okay.
No, I mean it. You know what I mean? It's like I would see, you know, him walk around. His hair never looked that clean. You know what I mean? It was all that stuff. He wasn't, you know, George Hamilton or something.
Yes. I'm just going to repeat the question so that everyone can hear it in the back. It's, do you intentionally choose to play unsympathetic characters, connecting perhaps Capote, owning Mahoney as a compulsive gambler who betrays everyone, and Punch-Drunk Love as a sleazy guy?
Yes, and just like, is there any connection or is there any conscious choice on your part?
Is that a conscious choice on your part?
Yeah. I love assholes, you know, it's a play. Well, you know, no, it's a good question. I think everybody's on this. I think no one deserves sympathy, and that everyone deserves sympathy. Do you see what I'm saying? I don't think there's anyone on the planet that, if looked at closely enough, is worthy of being judged in a way that it would be not good. And everybody on the planet, if looked at closely enough, is worthy of being loved with the most love you could ever give. I think that's human. I think that's human nature. I think that's everybody. I mean, even the nicest person you know, if you looked at them close enough, you would find something and you would go, ooh. And I find that to be part of humanity and part of the world and part of us and what makes us up. And anybody who's been in a relationship longer than a couple of years knows that. Do you know what I'm saying? It's like you fall in love, and you're there, and a few years later, you might still be in love, but man, you found out enough shit. You know what I mean? Where you're like, why the hell do you do that? Why'd you just say that? Why'd you disappear? You know, whatever. You know what I'm saying? And I think that sometimes, that's my answer to whenever I'm asked that question, that's my answer, because I think some of these characters are very openly, easily judged. Yes, but when I'm dealing with those characters, then the fun thing to look for is actually, well, where is the empathy? And then vice versa, too.
Actually, in the clip that we showed from Almost Famous, it's you telling Patrick Fugit, you have to be honest and unmerciful.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. And that resonated for me while watching Capote, because in many ways that describes, I think, the way Truman Capote related to Perry and others.
Yeah.
And I think your very first lines in the film are about, I'm honest, I say if it's biographical or autobiographical.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing that those two words are important, although sometimes unmerciful changes to merciful when you play somebody.
Sure. Yep.
Down here.
Yeah.
Question about True West, where you and John C. Reilly alternated parts on different nights. What was that experience like? And he also mentioned that he loves his performance as Scotty in Boogie Nights.
What was it like? It was great. It was a great experience. I mean, Sam Shepard wrote, he doesn't have a brother. He wrote the play in the late 70s in his mother's kitchen while his mother was in Alaska. Anyone knows the play, that's the opening lines of the play. Where's Ma? She's in Alaska, something like that. You know, and so it's pretty easy to come to the conclusion that this is the two halves of himself. And that one director did, for sure. And he had done it like that in London like 5 years before with two other actors, and he realized it was very successful. And it does, it works. You end up knowing the other person so well because you're actually gonna be in their shoes or have been in their shoes. You're actually gonna be in their shoes that night and we're in their shoes yesterday. We were able to get under each other's skin in a way that I've never experienced before. And it made a very long run incredibly fresh almost every time. Mm. It was really good.
Over there and then down here, yes. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you.
We all know that Capote was an alcoholic, but did his alcoholism intensify after doing
We all know that Truman Capote was an alcoholic. Did his alcoholism intensify after the experience of writing in Cold Blood?
I think so. Yeah, from what I read and what I looked at and what I heard, yeah. But that's it's a good question because this event in the film that you watch, I think, had something to do with his downfall. And another thing was his alcoholism. But it wasn't just one thing. And I don't think they could be compartmentalized. I think they all were intertwined. And I do think his drinking and his pill taking and these things was ultimately going to kill him. But why was he doing those things? And I think this film has to do a lot with why. Yeah, but I guess absolutely.
Yes.
First, the comment, I saw you in the sequel several times each time you were on board.
First, a comment, I saw you a few times in the Seagull and each time you broke my heart.
Thank you.
Question, with all this celebrity that is now surrounding you, how do you keep yourself grounded?
How do you keep yourself grounded, or can you? Are you grounded?
I have dirty fingernails. Oh God! I'm all with it. Yeah, I'm. just sorry. I'm not gonna have a giggling fit for that. I just. No, man, no. I'm like, I'm trying to, because it's a really good question, because I think the film has to do with it. Celebrity. The film has a lot to do with celebrity, and I had to really look at that, what celebrity does. What it can do to people, and what people with it can do to people. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot to do with that. That celebrity, that thing called celebrity, came from New York and landed in Kansas and like went, And I had to look at that when I was making the film. What is that? Those things. And, you know, it's another thing of life. It's everything. Life changes, you know. One of the things that happens if you're an actor, and sometimes it happens to some actors or musicians or writers or whoever, is that they become well-known and your life changes. And what it does is that it changed slowly over time. And I was just telling this the other night. It's something, and then before you realize it, all of a sudden you've lost your anonymity, and that your anonymity is like your hair color or your eye color. It just is. Meaning your private and public just is. So you don't think about it. You just are. You have two arms. You're private and public. You walk down the street and think private thoughts and are alone with yourself around other people. And you don't think you don't even think about it because that's just what is. And all of a sudden, when that kind of starts to slide away, it's spooky. Because all of a sudden, you're like sitting someplace, and I was telling you the other day that people start to look at you, and you think people want to fight you. Because you have absolutely no idea that that's happening, and it's so foreign that you don't think it's a reality, and it's not at all what you're thinking about at the time. And I remember, you know, like my late 20s, early 30s, when it first started, I remember thinking, like, I remember saying actually to a few people, you got a problem? and they'd be like, oh no, I just saw it on the TV, I saw it, you know, and you're like, oh, I'm an asshole, you know, and it's this slow kind of thing that I had moving toward. And so, yeah, you try to keep your head above, but it is a massive change. It's a massive change that this thing celebrity does. And it does take a time to adjust and keep your head above water and not have to start walking to public places knowing that you are not private anymore. And it's something you actually are aware of now. I don't know, just think about that. It's weird. So like, yeah, you keep your head above water, but it is a big change, and it is something that I think we've seen in this country and over time. There's some people that it's killed. I mean, I hate to be so dramatic, but there's some people that are so sensitive that that happened to them and they could not bear it. You know, but I think the majority of us, this is fine and it's all great. But I do think that some people just can't. Have not been able to deal with it.
Okay, up in the balcony, and then I've got somebody down here. Yes.
When Capote first came out, I saw it, and everybody was saying, oh my God, he's a shoo-in for the Oscar, he's just fantastic, he's the best, he's amazing. And then Brokeback Mountain. Everybody started talking about his legend. So you were just talking about keeping yourself grounded and how it is to be a celebrity.
Did everyone hear the question just briefly? The question is, when Capote came out, everyone knew you were a shoo-in for the Oscar and remained so, but now there's all the talk about Heath Ledger and Brokeback Mountain. No one knew he had that in him, but now he's also being talked about. How does that affect you, if at all?
I'm losing sleep. It's fucking Heath Ledger. Damn you! Steal my fire! I'm sorry. You know what? Deep down inside, honestly, it's like, I fucking want to see it, man. You know, I'm like, I'm hearing all these things, and I really want to see it because I know it's going to crush me. I know his performance is gonna crush me.
Yeah, but you deserve the Oscar.
No, but I appreciate that. But that's the truth, because it's easy to get caught up in that, and I'm not trying to say I'm above that, of feeling those feelings and those competitive feelings, something like that. But if you sit alone with yourself, and you're alone with yourself, and you're there, and it's like, what made me want to be an actor? And it's seeing a performance like that, probably. And so, you know, and that's the thing you got to keep in front of your face. And if you lose that, then it's going to be hellish. But if you keep that in front of your face, and I really try to keep that in front of my face, and I kind of can't wait to see him do it, because no one said anything but that he's just incredible. You know, and he broke my heart in that. I know he's going to break my heart, because he broke my heart in that goddamn movie where he shot himself in front of his father. What movie?
Monsters Ball.
Oh, shit. He should have deserved like 5 Oscars for that moment. Remember that moment? I was like, oh my God, I can't watch this anymore. It was like one of the most awful, tragic moments. He was just fucking amazing in that. So I just know that this film's going to be like that. It's going to kill me. But it is a weird thing. Thank you.
Gentleman over there, then one here, and then here. Yes.
What is it like working with Paul Thomas Anderson? You've made 4 films together.
Yeah, he's a very good friend of mine. I actually met him the first night of Heart 8, which is his first feature. The night I showed up to shoot that scene, that was the first time I ever met him, and I remember his hair was all cut off, and he was young and had more energy than anybody should ever be allowed to have. And I just love him. I love him to death. And so, like, working with him is like working with somebody who's like your brother, but not. And there's nowhere to hide, man. There's just nowhere to hide. I mean, there's a lot of joking around and a lot of laughs. But basically, I know that I have to do the best work when he's right there, because that's what he's going to want. And if he doesn't give it to me, he's going to tell me. But he's a dear friend. He's much more of a friend now than a collaborator.
And I would just recommend to those of you, I mean, probably most of you have seen Magnolia and Boogie Nights, maybe even Punch Drunk Love, because that was a recent release, but Heart 8 is a wonderful little film starring another triple-named person who deserves a night at the Y, Philip Baker Hall. I think he's one of the great actors, too, as well as Samuel L. Jackson and Gwyneth Paltrow and John C. Reilly. It's set in the gambling world, but it's about a lot of surprises emotionally and psychologically. Yes. Are you going to bring Judas Iscariot back? This refers to one of the plays.
This is a play that Stephen Adler Gierges wrote, The Last Days of Judas Iscariot, which we did at the Public last year. There's been talk of it trying to do it on the West Coast. I've never wanted to do a play on the West Coast, but I just have a feeling this play would be perfect. And anybody who knows the play might know what I mean. I just feel like it would land there and just hit. Like, I just think it'd be fantastic in that town. But I hope so. Yeah, he's really, I think, one of our great playwrights. He is just a special, special talent. But I hope so, yeah.
Okay, question over there.
Yeah, are there any roles that you turned down
any roles that you turned down and now kick yourself for doing so?
No, because if I didn't do it, I wasn't supposed to do it. I know it sounds like I'm healthier than I am, and that's true. I'm not nearly as healthy as that statement at all. But it's true. It's just like, it's like that with life, I'm sure, for everybody. But I just know it's like, man, if I didn't act in it, I wasn't supposed to act in it. You know what I mean? And whether that guy goes on to, you know, win a billion Oscars or whatever, it's just then he was supposed to do it. You know, he obviously was that great. He was supposed to, that kind of thing. I don't think about it too much.
We have time for maybe one more question. Gentleman there, and then someone down here. Yes.
Are there any aspects of Capote you found in your research that didn't make it into the film as much as you would have liked by seeing it? And during your process,
were there any aspects of Truman Capote that you discovered doing your research that didn't get into the film as much as you would have liked? Or any other aspects when you were developing the character that you were worried wouldn't get in? Is that? And if Truman Capote could see the movie, what do you think he would think of it?
No, and this is to the first question, and this is why, because the film deals with aspects of Capote that I don't think anybody has ever thought of actually showing, in my view, which is this him alone. I mean, I don't know. I don't think people think about Truman in the past and go, God, I really want to see him walk into his townhouse when no one's home and stand in the foyer, you know, with his manuscript, and then walk upstairs and put the suitcase down and come down and put it on the desk. You know, I just don't think anybody really thought of it. That's how I want to see Truman Capote. Everybody wants to see Truman Capote be Truman Capote, which is what we know who that is. You know, the raconteur, you know, the personality. And this film was going to be dealing with so many other things other than that quality that actually I felt like I got to cover the gamut in this part, in this film, in this story. I think I got to actually touch on a lot of things about him that maybe I wouldn't have if somebody else had written it. But it's a good question. And Capote, I don't know. I think, you know, my pat answer, which is really just pat, which is he'd probably be very critical of it, I'm sure, because it's a film, so there's liberties that are taken in it. And also I think the film's very critical of him, highly critical of him. But I think he would have liked it too, because we're all sitting here talking about him again, you know what I mean? It's like, look, they're on the stage again. No, that's where I did the reading, you know what I mean? I think he would get a kick out of that.
Hope so. All right, last question right here. Yes.
What made you want to be an actor? Where did you study?
Well, it's kind of a corny story. My mother was a big fan of the theater. We grew up in Rochester, New York, which is about 6 hours from here. And she was a big, she has four kids, I'm one of four. There was a regional house in my hometown, the Jiva Theater, and it's this big old theater now, but it used to be in this small place. And they would bring actors in from New York and do plays. And so it was as professional as I was gonna see, you know. And when I was around 11 or 12, she got season tickets to the Jiva Theater for me and her. I don't know why that happened, why the other kids didn't get in on that, but I don't know. She liked me a lot or something. It was a very true story. I was very small. I was very small until I was about the end of my sophomore year in high school. I looked like Truman. You know, I was a tiny guy. And there was general seating at this theater. And I'll just tell his story because this is what it was about. And my mom's a chronically late woman. I hated it when I was young for it, you know what I mean? And we'd give each other crap all the time about that. But so at 8 o'clock, five of eight, the doors would open to the theater. And you were basically people just swarmed in and sat where they could sit. It was general seating. So we'd get there like 5 of 8. Like right before those doors would open, and the people would be backed up to the street, the door to the street, and I'd go in, and I was very small, like, you know, and I'd wheedle my way through everybody, go up to the door of the theater, the door would open, I'd prance in there and sit in the front row, and put a program next to me. My mom would walk in last and sit down in the front row, and I thought maybe that's why she's bringing me, Well, that's a true story, and we did that a bunch of times. But the first play I saw there was All My Sons by Arthur Miller, and I was 11, 12. And this is the bottom line truth. I remember thinking that I had found something that no one knew existed. I remember thinking, oh my God, where has this been? Where has this been? You know, where have you been all my life? I mean, really, I remember feeling like, oh my, I couldn't believe. And I've told this story so many times. I just remember that play so vividly in my head, and I don't remember anything, you know. And I remember the father, you know, everyone knows that play, the father walking off and shoots himself, you know. And I remember just 12 and just bawling in the front row, you know, and just thinking, why did he kill himself? And I remember just thinking when I got older, what it was is like, as I was eight, it's like, well, I couldn't get enough of it. I was so addicted to going and just sitting in and watching it because people were making me think that something was happening in front of me that was real, but it wasn't, and I couldn't bear that was actually happening. I couldn't deal with it. It was so overwhelmingly beautiful and awesome to me that there were people in there that were doing that for other people. They were getting up in front of people and making you believe something was happening that wasn't fucking happening. I couldn't believe it. You know, and actually invested themselves and moved us in that way. And I was just absolutely addicted and in love with it. But I didn't get into, because I was an athlete at that time, and I did all the sports. I didn't think it would be anything I'd do. But by the time the door opened for me to do it, I ran right toward it, you know. But that's really why. It's the place I wanted to be, you know.
I know that there are more questions. I have plenty more myself, but I think on this note, all I can tell you is that on the one hand, yes, I'm putting all my money on you for Oscar night, but don't let that be the main thing. On the other hand, I just wanted to thank you and congratulate you, because whatever additional awards you win, I mean, you've won quite a few already for this film, I think you've made it clear that none of us can ever think of you as an actor in the same way again. You're not just another really good actor. Capote makes it clear that you are a great actor.
Thank you.
No matter what the awards are, we'll remain.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's really nice.